Hey, you guys, this is Professor Vitt. This is our first lecture on confirmation bias. What you're going to find is I'm going to give you the information. I'm going to zip through it pretty quick. I won't have much time for chit-chat, and that's going to be the norm because I want you to see these videos and move on. If you have a question, stop and rewind the video. See if I don't answer it. If I don't, please feel free to follow up and email me. But generally speaking, these will be short and sweet lectures that I give. Okay, well, let's start with something called confirmation bias. This is the most important thing that we can start the course with. And the book buries it at the end, but we really need to talk about it beforehand. Confirmation bias is a fancy way of saying that someone's wearing a blindfold. Essentially, they are seeing the world a certain way, and they're seeing it incorrectly. A great little example, a great analogy would be the Wizard of Oz. Now, in the original Wizard of Oz, when someone gets to the Emerald City, they have to put these glasses on. And here's a picture of some glasses. And they're essentially, they've got little locks on them. And what happens is when you put these glasses on, you're then allowed to go into the Emerald City. And when they ask, well, why are you putting these glasses on me? The response is, well, it's to protect you from the grandeur of the Emerald City. You know, it's this very regal place and you need to be protected from the sight. And what's so amazing about the Emerald City is that everything in it is green. The people are green, you know, the sky is green, the earth is green, all the bricks are green. It's just really neat. But what's really happening, of course, you know, as the reader, is that the glasses that you're putting on are green, and that's what makes the Emerald City have its character. Well, that happens with confirmation bias. We all have our own glasses that we put on, our own perspective that we see the world through, and there's no way to get around it. They're locked to our face. And if we want to maximize the number of true beliefs that we have and minimize the number of false beliefs that we have, we need to be aware of the lenses that we use in order to see the world. So let me give you the formal definition of confirmation bias, then I'm going to give you a few examples of it, okay? And they'll be pretty different, so you'll get a pretty good idea of what it is. Confirmation bias is the tendency to just seek or find confirming evidence for what you believe and to ignore all the disconfirming evidence that you're presented with. So let me show you some examples. The first and probably the most famous involves full moons and crime. And there is an old sort of there's an impression that a number of emergency room workers have. So we're talking about doctors, we're talking about nurses, people who are very intelligent and who have been given a great deal of training. And they all tend to think that crime goes up during a full moon. Now, they've done a number of statistical analyses and they've shown that this is not the case. In fact, it's completely wrong that there is no sense in which crime increases or violent behavior increases or admissions increase. I mean, they've looked at lots of different metrics for this, but people are wondering, well, why would everyone think that? You know, these are very smart people. Maybe we're missing something. And what turns out happening is this. When there's a crazy full moon, and the emergency room is super busy. People notice it. They remember it, right? So John's at work. He's working the emergency room. It's a crazy night. And he says, my gosh, what a nutty night. Oh, and somebody says, well, it was a full moon. And he goes, aha, you see, there you go. Now, next month, when it's a full moon again, maybe it's not very crazy. But he doesn't think of that, right? It's just a regular shift. He comes in, he works his shift, and then that's it. But he's going to forget that that night that was a full moon wasn't necessarily that crazy. But he will remember that one case where it was a full moon and it was crazy. Also, he will forget all those nights in between where things were crazy, right? In other words, he's counting the hits, the one night where it was a really crazy night in the emergency room, and he's forgetting all those nights where it was crazy anyway, and those nights where it was a full moon and it wasn't crazy. Let me give you another example of this. These are called Wason problems, and this is from research that started back in the 60s and the 70s. It's much celebrated. It's been repeated a number of times since then. It's a little complex problem, but it's pretty straightforward. So let's take it slow. Suppose we have four cards, labeled A and D on one side. They have letters on one side and numbers on the other. And I tell you that I want to confirm a rule. I want to try and prove this rule is true. Which cards will I turn over? Right, so if this rule is true, which one of these four cards up here would I turn over? So the rule says if A is on one side of a card, then there is a three on the other. Okay, so what cards would I turn over if I want to prove that this sentence is true? Well, most people, in fact, north of 90% of the people who are polled will tell you this. If A is on one side of the card, then there's a three on the other. In order to prove that that is true, in order to show that that's true, in order to demonstrate that that is true, I would turn over a card that has an A on it and a card that has a three on it. And the thinking is usually as follows. This card has an A on it. If I turn it over and there's a three, I've confirmed it. If I turn it over and there's a four on the other side of this card, then I've proven that, it's false, right? Likewise, if I have the card that has a three on it and I turn it over and there's an A, then I've confirmed the hypothesis, right? But it turns out this is a really hard problem for people. You would actually want to turn over the seven. And the reason why is this. If I turn over the card that has a seven on it and there's an A on the other side of it, then the rule would be wrong, right? Then the rule that if there's an A on one side of the card, then there's a three on the other, right? The number seven card gives you the opportunity to falsify or prove wrong this rule. But people have a real difficult time handling this. What is going on? Well, it turns out that we're willing to confirm the case involving A and 3, our rule, but when it comes to 7, it's hard for people to figure that out. And that's because we have a natural tendency to want to prove what we think is true, but we don't want to disconfirm it, right? We only look for cases where our theory is correct, not cases where it falls apart. But we always want to look at cases where our theories fall apart, and that's kind of the focus of this class. We're going to be looking at cases where we have extraordinary claims, where, most of the time we look at the night sky, there's no UFO in it. But once in a while, somebody says they do see this, right? Or someone makes a claim about being psychic, right? Most of the time, if someone is talking about the future, it's because they don't know what it's like. Most of us don't, apparently. But occasionally people will say, no, I think I'm able to see the future, or I had a vision and there was something that I saw and so forth. The question is, how could we prove that right or wrong? And so we want to be careful of confirmation bias. This will come up again and again and again and again in different contexts. Talking to the dead, this will be an issue. People seeing things by remote viewing. So we'll see this come up again and again. Remember, so looking at the Wason task, this is a little complex, it's a little abstract, but the idea is when you pick the seven, right, you're disconfirming your belief. We naturally want to turn over the A and the three because we want to confirm the rule. But we really should also want to turn over the seven, right? Okay, so example number three, and probably the best, is Mary Toft. Who is Mary Toft and what does it matter? Okay, in 1726, Mary Toft convinced the king's surgeon that she had given birth to a rabbit. No joke. This is a contemporary drawing. It was published in a paper, I believe, at the time. And this is Mary Toft, and she's purportedly giving birth to a rabbit. Now, what she did was she feigned birth, like she feigned labor. So she acted like she was in labor, and then she called on a doctor. And when the doctor got there, the doctor saw, most remarkably, she appeared to deliver portions of a rabbit, of a baby rabbit. Obviously, they were just parts. And the doctor just couldn't believe this. I mean, there was no precedent for this. No one had ever seen a human give birth to a rabbit. It would be an unusual thing then, as it is now. Now, they didn't know anything about DNA back then, but it would have been an unusual event. Now, how is it that this lady was able to con the King of England's surgeon into believing this? Well, it turns out she conned a bunch of medical professionals into believing this was true. And in a funny way, she got lucky. She was playing on their confirmation bias. Here's what is happening. At the time, there is something called the doctrine of maternal impressions. And what that means is, occasionally people would be born and they would have some kind of deformity, mental deformity, or they would be deaf or some type of physical deformity, and doctors didn't understand why. And what doctors thought was going on was, for instance, a child was born deaf because the mother heard a very loud noise during her pregnancy. Or if someone was born and they were deformed, it was because the mother was attacked or beaten when she was holding the baby. And the impression that the mother had was then somehow imprinted on the child, on the fetus, on the baby. And that explained deformities for them, for medical doctors. They didn't understand anything about hormones or DNA or cellular formation, no clue. So this was their best guess as to what was going on. And it appeared to them that they had a lot of data for this. Children would be born deaf, and the mother would recall hearing some loud noise or something like that. It's not so far-fetched. I mean, we think nowadays that, for instance, a mother's diet will affect the health of a baby, or that if a mother has very high sugar, she can then pass that on to a baby, and the baby can have physical effects from that. So it's not completely out of left field, but Mary Toft was clever. Well, she was lucky. I don't know. She was terribly clever. There's no evidence that she knew how to read or write. But what she told doctors was, they asked her, how could this possibly happen? And what she said was, well, before I had the rabbit, before I had the baby, I had a craving for rabbit meat. And I used to eat it all the time. And when I wasn't eating it, I was thinking about it. And I would spend hours of my time going through my garden looking for rabbits. And I would dream about rabbits. I would think about them every waking moment. And what doctors thought happened was, oh, all of this attention, eating all of this rabbit meat and thinking about rabbits while she was pregnant, then caused her baby to become a rabbit. Right, so she physically appeared to deliver parts of a rabbit. Doctors couldn't believe this, but they had this theory about maternal impression, and something that happened to a mother could affect a baby. And whenever she mentioned all these things about, wanting to eat rabbit meat and thinking about rabbits all the time and going through her garden looking for rabbits, the doctors thought, oh. Well, that makes perfect sense. This really could be just a case of maternal impression. Now, even at the time, even in 1726, this was a pretty crazy idea. It wasn't like in 1726, doctors didn't think this was really possible. This had never been done before. A human had never given birth to a different type of animal ever in the history of the world. I mean, there might be folklore or legend or something like that, but this just didn't happen regularly. And it was never quite clear why doctors believed this. And the doctors who were sort of taken in by her were all pretty heavily ridiculed for it. But psychologists have looked back years later and said, oh, it makes perfect sense why these doctors, all educated individuals, would be led so far astray. They had already believed this doctrine of maternal impression, and so they were just going to carry this through to the bitter end. It was just a form of confirmation bias. So that's an example. So what do you need to know about that? I'll do a little recap slide at the end, what you need to know about confirmation bias. But that's the start of it. Okay. Now I'm going to switch slides here to something that looks a little bit different to you, and I hope you can make out some of the words. But what you have is the name of some books. And there are names of books with little blue dots, and then there are names of books with little red dots. And what this is the book buying patterns of people on Amazon.com. And what they find is people who buy End of America, also buy Shock Doctrine, buy Give Me Liberty, who buy Dark Side, who buy Angler, who buy War Within. All of these blue books are liberal books. They're democratic books. They're books that someone who might like Barack Obama, they would buy those books. And then when you look at the red dots, those are all more conservative books. And there is no crossover, right? So if somebody is buying a book that is called Liberal Fascism, they are not buying a book that says Loser Take All. What this means is people don't buy books that they don't agree with. If you are someone who is liberal, you're very unlikely to pick up a book written by a conservative author. And that's a form of confirmation bias. Remember, in this course, what I want to do is try and present you with some examples of things that might stretch your worldview a little bit and then force you to evaluate the evidence on that basis. So that's just another little example of confirmation bias. Now, this might be tough to read right here. It'll pop up in another slide, but what we find happens often in conjunction with confirmation bias is something called the backfire effect. What the backfire effect is, when people are challenged by contradictory evidence, they don't revise their beliefs, but their beliefs become stronger. So what does that mean? It means that if I truly believe that crime gets a little bit crazier during a full moon, and I am presented with considerable evidence that this is not the case, perhaps because I'm already working in an emergency room, then any attempt to, sorry, you guys, I'm cycling through this. Whenever I'm presented with evidence where this doesn't appear to be the case, I won't change my mind. Instead, I'll dig in deeper, right? So think about this chart involving politics. It always happens, right, that you speak to someone who is of a different political position than you, and you can present them with evidence supporting your arguments. And rather than concede the point, they will begin to sort of tear apart your own views by refusing to acknowledge the evidence. They'll put a lot more, how do I put that more clearly? They will spend a lot more energy trying to work around the evidence you've presented, and they are far less likely to accept it Then simply say, you are correct. So what does this look like in a context where you're talking about, say, psychic events? Well, someone may go to a reading, say what's called a cold reading, and someone will say, oh, I'm looking for a person with a name that starts with D. I'm picking that up. And somebody in a big audience may say, oh, my father's name was Darren. You must be picking him up. And they say, oh, great. We have Darren here. Darren, we must be picking up your father. It looks like he is motioning towards his hand or his chest or his face. And the person says, gosh, I don't know why he would be doing that. He died of cancer or something like that. People remember that someone guessed a name starting with the letter D, but they forget the next immediate question, which is something like, oh, he's putting his hand near his chest or his face, right? So that you'll remember the hits, but you'll forget the misses. If you want to kind of go the other way, what you can say is, when you present someone, say you're presenting a skeptic with evidence of someone trying to do a cold reading, and someone says, look, here's someone trying to do cold reading, and they've named this person's, you know, they've located a name for this person and a condition and so forth. Rather than accept that as evidence, the skeptic might be more willing to say, well, wait a minute here. How general or specific is this, right? They're not going to accept the new data. They're not going to revise their own beliefs. They're just going to become more strong, right? So we'll see this as time goes on. I'll point out the backfire effect repeatedly throughout this course if I haven't made it clear enough. What you need to know is confirmation bias, what it is, right? We look to confirming evidence and we ignore contrary evidence, and also what the backfire effect is. Beliefs challenged by contrary evidence are made stronger. They're not revised. Think of politics, right? Never get into a disagreement about politics. You're just going to run your wheels with someone because they're not going to change their mind, right? They believe the way that they do. Now, why is it like this? Well, it's simple. There's something called, and this is too much information, but there's something called the dual processing tradition. And what that means is this. When we talk about the world and we think about the world and we have beliefs about the world, we really have two systems going on, right? We have one system that is like a reflex. It's just the way we think. It's the way that we see things. And then we have a system that is more deliberate and it's rational. Confirmation bias is immediate. So you have confirmation bias. Everyone does. There is no way to get around it, right? The evidence will always be slanted based on what you want to be true to begin with, right? So you have to be aware of the confirmation bias, and you have to be aware that there's not much you can do, at least initially, to remove it. What you can do is be aware of your tendency to just kind of be biased in that way, and be aware of a backfire effect. So this was just a real brief start to confirmation bias. It's awesome in the book, but it's important that you get a handle on it early on and you realize that the person who is most likely to deceive yourself is you. You will do a better job of it than anyone else. So that's just the start of confirmation bias. It's to get your feet wet. It's 24 minutes. It's super long. I apologize it took so long to get that out. Okay.